Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm going to follow up on the previous presentation by showing also how in a European-funded project called Food Secure, we have developed a collaborative approach first between different research institutions, but also with stakeholders, and showing how we can quantify this. So our starting point is that looking in 2050, we can imagine very different future. And we need also to combine knowledge and insight from different disciplines, different actors, to be able to shape these different pathways to different future. But we need also serious quantitative analysis to be able to assess the features of this different future, but also to provide feedback to the stakeholders to know if what they think is realistic, and if there is what kind of price tag is associated with each scenario. And very early on in the process, when we start to involve stakeholders and reviewing what type of future we can look at for 2050, we have looked at the different scenario developed in the climate change community around the IPCC scenario in terms of emission and the the shared socioeconomic pathway, the SSPs. And what has appeared is that they were poorly designed in terms of food and nutrition security. These scenarios have been designed thinking about climate change. But food and nutrition security involve much more details about social impact, about also how heterogeneous the world can be. And therefore, we had to create a new set of scenarios. And the process, I'm going to review it quickly, but you have also publication that give you these details. So the idea is to be able to bring stakeholders and researchers to a common ground. So the process has been very integrated, meaning that in the same workshop, you will bring both the stakeholders that can be from the private sector, from NGO, and it was, even if it's a European project, it was really a global community of stakeholders. But at the same time, with first a very good team to be able to extract the information we need from them, but also bringing at the same time the knowledge of the quantitative experts, even the modelers, to make sure that the type of story we describe makes sense from a modeling point of view, but also from basic data that are available. Because interacting with stakeholders, you will see that in many cases we have a high level of expertise on very specific issue, but they may lack the big picture or some of the interaction and linkages that, at the opposite, when you do modeling, you have in mind. You know, you have some balance. You need to have things that are consistent. If you start to talk, as I'm going to talk about inequalities, you need to know what means inequalities. Is it between countries, within countries? Why we have inequalities? Is it because we lack redistribution? Is it because technology is biased versus unskilled people? All of this will matter at one point in time. So from this exercise, we have both storylines, so with the scenario that describe elements about governance, inequalities, diet, but also we have used the stakeholder to do some quantification, you know, what it means to have a high level of population growth or low level. If you just have this in a story, a modeler can imagine quite a lot of implementation solutions. So we have tried to ask them to do a little more homework for us and really to push the type of output we can get from them that would be input for our models. So we had different set of workshop, and the basic things is that for a set of drivers, here I represent, for example, the yield for corn. We have shown them what was the evolution for the last 50 years. In order to see that if we go to the future, it's important to know what was the past. What was the last evolution? Because otherwise, people can get wild. So on this graph, for instance, you see for four groups of countries, the red line is for high-income countries, while in purple is for the least developed economies, what was the evolution of yield? And from the beginning, you understand why we are in a world that has so many inequalities, because just in terms of yield, the performance of this group were quite different. High-income countries have started from a higher level, and their growth rate was even higher than the least developed economies. So starting from this, we have asked them to continue to draw the lines. So in the workshop, for all the set of indicators, they start to put really explicit illustration on their storyline, what it means, you know, higher growth, lower growth, and things like this. So we have collected this. And after, we will use it in our model. In a similar way to what was presented before, when you bring these people together, when you identify driver assumption at the end, and if you have the right skills of people to do this job, you can aggregate some scenario that will be coherent, okay? And in our case, we have four scenarios. And they are basically distributed over two axes. One is about the sustainability, so the kind of, and more here, environmental sustainability, from highly sustainable to unsustainable, and from the social implication in terms of equality inequal. And we have basically these four scenario. One was called the 1% world, where you have a highly concentration of wealth and income in 1% of the population. But because also they have ownership on nearly all natural resources, they will optimize and they will get something that can be sustainable from an environmental point of view. You know, a lot of problem we have in terms of unsustainability is a lack of property rights in many natural resources. So you can imagine a world where everything has been privatized and these people manage it for their own interest, but they manage it. The opposite case, the ecotopia, you still have here sustainability, but the overall governance is much more redistributive, and everyone tried to make an effort to achieve a better life on this earth, meaning that waste is going to be reduced, and so on. But at the same time, it can seem a kind of very nice thing, but it will require a lot of change in behaviors. We are going to eat less meat. We are going to do more effort to reduce waste. And naturally, mankind is not doing this. So it means that you have to reformat the software of people. So how you do it is a quite important issue. Now you have two scenarios that are unsustainable. One, the light blue here is food for all, but not forever, meaning that we continue to have a kind of highly productive agriculture, highly intensive. We are going to feed the planet without problem, but we may touch some limit at one point. And we have the too little too late, where we don't invest in R&D, we don't make effort, the world becomes more fragmented, and at the end we will see more crises and the world will collapse to some extent. This has different implications, so in terms of population, in terms of projection, you see that if I look, for instance, to the here for the yield for the middle income country, in the food for all but not forever, you see a decline of yield at the end of the period due to an increase of climatic events. While in the 1% world, where things are managed by an elite, you have continuous innovation and increase in yield. Same thing for the population, and you will see also movement of population between group of countries. And here, for instance, you see that in this food for all but not forever, you will see a slight increase of the high-income population countries by 2050 compared to the scenario, because we will have migration. Okay, if you don't have food in your country, you move to a place where you have food. So basically, you will move to developed economies. And based on the history of mankind, building a wall will not block this. So now we adjust the models to take into account this. So in this consortium, we have different institutions that are using different models that have their own comparative advantages. Here we are focusing on the what we call a computable generic model, that is a very complex model that have a lot of interaction. And this version is a miracle version for long run. And we have adjusted it to be able to match this exercise. Because in this type of model, a lot of things are endogenous. So basically, yield are response to the economic system. But we want that our models duplicate the yields from the scenario, because we want to give the quantitative assessment of what stakeholders have in mind. So it means that we need to make endogenous some technology that in most of the cases are exogenous in what we are used to do to deal with this. But very important in this type of model is also to have a story about your macroeconomic drivers, how your current account is going to balance, how your real exchange rate is going to balance, because it will have a quite significant implication about where the food will be produced at the end. And same thing for inequalities. So I'm going now to show you some of the results. First, about the increase. So in this model, you can track things on trade in terms of calorie consumption and so on. Just to give you an illustration about a story about inequalities within countries, on this graph, you see how the poor people calories consumption evolve compared to the average people in an economy. And depending on the scenario, it will change. But if you look at this graph, you see that the 1% case here, the poor people at the end will be very close to the evolution of the average people. And for a policymaker, you can say it's a good thing. But in the 1% scenario, it means that you are just crushing the middle class on the long run. So it's not that the poor become better off in absolute term. It's because if the middle class start to face more food and nutrition security issues, not say challenges, inequality can be reduced for most of the population because you make everyone worse off. So just when we think about inequalities, what it means for the very poor, for the poor and the middle class on the long run is quite important. In terms of commodity, also you will see different in terms of dynamic of prices. Here I just took three examples about meat, about wheat and rice. This is rice, as you can see here. And we are going also to see very different dynamics. But typically in the in some scenario that are not sustainable, like the food for all but not forever, you see that we are going to have very strong increase in prices in terms of some commodity, in particular wheat, because wheat will be used for both the human consumption and the animal consumption. So if we have unsustainable diet, we are going also to consume more meat, and a resource like wheat will have much more competition in terms of demand, and we'll have higher structure and prices. When for rice, the story will be different, still an increase in price of rice, but lower than wheat. So you see these different things, and same thing for meat. And of course, you have also implication of land use. Different scenario, different implication, I will not enter in detail, but just the fact that something that is quite common to most of the scenario is we are going to see a significant relocation of land from pasture to cropland if we want to have some level of sustainability. So that will be very important. What we do with land is quite important. So in terms of conclusion, what I want really to say that it's quite important to have this quantitative and rigorous quantitative assessment linked to any qualitative story. Because in many cases, stakeholders can build a world that is not coherent or for which they don't imagine side consequences in terms of trade imbalances, in terms of cost of the food. You know, a quantitative balance, meaning that the fact that the demand equals the supply and that we have enough food to feed the planet, may be achieved at very different costs. So bringing the cost part of the story is important. I didn't discuss population, but population is a very important driver. And even by 2050, we still have uncertainties about what will be the level of population, but it will be a key driver in some of the challenges we face. Inequalities, I've said, between countries, within countries, we really need to focus on this because in terms of food and nutrition outcome, it's critical. Understanding the drivers, that's very important if we want to design policy action, you know, why we have more or less inequality, that's quite important. My last point is about, we talk a lot about agriculture, and the next presentation will give you a kind of state-of-the-art simple product about what you can do in agriculture. But we have to keep in mind that food and nutrition security has to be considered in a larger framework, and how macroeconomic imbalances or balancing will matter. In the type of simulation I have shown you, in some cases, you will see a change in the real exchange rate between India and the US of more than 30%. So when you think about long-term structural changes, about the competitiveness of an agriculture when you have a 30% change in exchange rate, that's very important. That's not defined within agriculture, but how the macroeconomic environment will change will have an impact on agriculture, where we produce food and so on. And on this topic, if you want to learn more, I'm just going to do some advertisement for a book from one of our colleagues, Eugenio Diaz-Bonilla. It's an IFPRI book that tried to connect this. But in terms of long-term design, I think, and global governance is quite important. Thank you.